Reflectometer. The reflectometer is an important application for directional couplers, and it is can be considered that a reflectometer is a circuit that uses directional coupler to isolate and sample the incident and reflected power from the load. Effectively, this reflectometer circuit is the key component in the measurement tools for microwave engineering, such as scalar network analyzer or vector network analyzer. It is based on simply if we have a microwave source, it will be connected to port 1, and the load will be connected to port 2, which is a through. Then a sample of the incident power is connected to port 3, which is a coupled signal to port 1, and this signal will be represented as V incident or VI, and a sample of the reflected power will be coupled to port 4, which is coupled to port 2, and this sample will be represented as V reflected or VR. By comparing the ratio of VR to V incident, we can introduce the value or the magnitude of the reflection coefficient gamma. So it can be used to measure the reflection coefficient of a one port network, and from the reflection coefficient we can also introduce other parameters like the standing wave ratio. The standing wave ratio, it can be represented as 1 plus the magnitude of gamma over 1 minus the magnitude of gamma. So it can also be used as an standing wave ratio meter or in power monitoring system. In the case of power monitoring system, we are interested to know if the source is excited or not. So by taking sample of the power and measuring the sample of the power in ports, we can know if the power is on or not. And on the other hand, we are maybe interested if the load is matched or not. For example, if we are connecting a power amplifier to an antenna, practically the antenna should be matched to the power amplifier. But assume that the antenna has been broken, for example, so there will be some mismatch. In this case, we should add a power meter at the reflected port to measure if there is large reflection at certain time. This large reflection will indicate that this antenna has been broken, for example, at this moment. So, in general, this block diagram of the reflectometer is the key circuit for most microwave measurements without interrupting the bus from the source to the load. In the operation, the direction coupler provides a sample V incident of the incident wave and a sample of V reflected of the reflected wave. A ratio meter with an appropriately calibrated scale can then measure these voltages V incident and V reflected to indicate the value in terms of the power. Because actually we have here a voltage ratio, for example, which can be detected, for example, by using a crystal detector, which measures the amplitude of the voltage or the RF voltage here and convert it into DC voltage. And from this DC voltage, we can measure the voltage using a simple voltmeter. But the question is, what is the relation between the measured DC voltage and the power incident at V incident here? So a ratio meter with an appropriately calibrated scale can then measure this voltage and provide reading in terms of reflection coefficient magnitude or standing wave ratio. So we can measure, but in addition to the measurement, we will need some calibration process. To analyze such simple reflectometer, we are going to use the signal flow graph of this reflectometer. So assuming that the coupler is reasonably matched. Reasonably matched means that port 1 is matched to the source and there is no reflection inside port 2 itself. So the power going from port 1 go to the load directly. If we have a reflection from the load, it would be some reflection from the load to port 1. Now we have two sampled signals. Sampled signal from port 1 to port 3 through the coupling coefficient. And sampled signal from port 2 to port 4 through coupling coefficient. In addition, due to the directivity of the direction coupler, some of the power in port 1 will be transferred directly to port 4 because it is not completely isolated. In this case, the power from port 1 to port 4 will be coupling over the directivity of the coupler. In a similar way, some of the power can be transferred from port 2 to port 3 due to the directivity. So some of the power will go from port 2 to port 3 after the reflection by the coupling over the directivity. So the total signal at port 3 V incident is composed from the coupled signal from port 1 and the directivity signal from port 2. On the other hand, the total signal at VR would be mainly the coupled signal from port 2 plus the directivity signal from port 1. So if we assume reasonably matched coupler with loose coupling such that the coupling coefficient is much less than unity, so that square root 1 minus c squared is nearly unity, so in this case we are assuming that almost all the power going from port 1 going to the load, and this will introduce the reflection coefficient multiplied by the total incident power. Then the circuit can be represented in the signal flow graph like this. Now by solving the signal flow graph, we can say that the total voltage at port 3 V incident is the coupling coefficient C plus C over D multiplied by the reflection coefficient gamma multiplied by a specific phase shift e to the power g theta. On the other hand, the total reflected voltage VR would be the coupling coefficient multiplied by the reflection coefficient gamma multiplied by certain phase e to the power g phi. In addition, we have the directivity coming from port 1, so it would be C over D. gamma here is the reflection coefficient of the load. D is the numerical directivity, which is 10 to the power, the directivity in dB over 20. theta and phi are unknown phase delays through the circuit. So, generally speaking, the maximum value of V incident, it would be when the value of the coupling coefficient will be in phase with the reflection coefficient C over D plus gamma. And the minimum value of V incident would be when they are out of phase. In a similar way, the maximum V reflected would be when they are in phase, and the minimum when would be out of phase. Now, if you are interested in VR over V incident, VR over V incident, the maximum value will occur when VR has a maximum value and V incident is a minimum value. So it would be C over D plus C gamma over C minus C over D multiplied by gamma. So by eliminating C, it can be represented as gamma plus 1 over D over 1 minus gamma over D. We have eliminated C and C from here. Alright? So, the maximum value for VR over V incident is the modulus of gamma plus 1 over D over 1 minus the modulus of gamma over V. On the other hand, the minimum value for V reflected over V incident is the minimum value of VR over the maximum value of V incident. The minimum value of VR would be gamma minus 1 over D over the maximum value 1 of V incident 1 plus gamma over D. So the value of VR over V incident lies between these two values, the maximum and the minimum value. Assuming that the directivity is infinity, so the value of VR over V incident is actually the modulus or the magnitude of the reflection coefficient. So for Kabler with infinite directivity, this is reduced to the desired value of gamma. So if we are using a high directivity Kabler, this means that the value of V reflected over the value of V incident is simply the reflection coefficient of the load, or the magnitude of the reflection coefficient of the load. Otherwise, we can say that the measured V reflected over V incident is gamma with uncertainty value with plus or minus 1 over D in this value. Effectively, good accuracy can be obtained if the directivity is more than 40 dB. This is the basic idea of the reflectometer circuit, which is the core for many microwave measurement systems. By this, we have already completed chapter 7 in the textbook of Pulsar Microwave Engineering, and chapter 7 was about the power dividers and directional couplers. Before ending this lecture and ending this chapter, let me remind with the starting point when we discussed why we need power dividers and directional couplers in microwave engineering. We said that in simple circuits, we have simple traces which can be used to divide the signal from point to another point. But actually, these simple traces cannot be applied directly in microwave engineering, because we have characteristic impedance, we have lengths with respect to the wavelengths or the operating wavelengths, we have coupling between lines and between nearby lines. So all these parameters should be taken into consideration in microwave circuits. So what we are doing in simple low frequency circuits, we cannot apply directly in microwave circuits. Also in the measurements, if we are interested, for example, in measuring the current through a certain circuit, it is so simple. We cut the circuit and connect the two probes of the ammeter in series with the circuit to measure the current. Such cutting transmission line in microwave circuits is not the appropriate way to take some measurements. Also, for measuring of the voltage, for example, we simply add two probes in parallel to the device under test, or the two points under test. Also, as we said in the directional coupler, for example, such simple configuration of adding just two lines in this case will completely make the circuit completely different from the original circuit, and the performance of the circuit will be completely different in microwave. That's why we have introduced different types of power dividers, microwave T's, and directional couplers in this chapter. Hopefully, you can find now the effort that we have done in studying power dividers and couplers is useful in microwave circuits. By this, we have completed chapter 7. In the next video, we are going to start with chapter 8 with microwave filters. See you in microwave filters.